God is good.
All the time.
And all the time,
God is good.
You know, that's one of those phrases that we throw around a lot at the church. I want to push against that just a little bit this morning, maybe play devil's advocate. If God is good all the time and all the time God is good, why do children die? By the hundreds of thousands of starvation every year. If God is good all the time and all the time God is good, why are there natural disasters that devastate the earth and claim human lives? If God is good all the time and all the time God is good, why are there saints who love God and who pray and who have faith and believe their prayers will be answered? Why do they die of cancer and sickness and disease? If God is good all the time and all the time God is good, why are humans so bad? I mean, if God is omnipotent, if he's all-powerful, couldn't God fix all this some way? If God's the creator of the universe that brought everything into existence, couldn't he have created a creation without suffering and evil and death? And what is our response as the church, as the people of God who proclaim the goodness of God in a world that's torn apart by sin and brokenness? I came to tell you today about suffering and evil and the good God. Grab your Bibles, we're going to need them this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. It is a light unto our path. It is a mirror that shows us who we are. It's a revelation of God that shows us who you are. And so we pray that this would not be just another time of a church service, but we come humbly seeking an encounter with you. We ask that you would cause these words to burst forth from their egg cage and live and dance in us, Lord Jesus. And we ask the Holy Spirit that you would unleash the power of your word in this place, and that you would give us the strength to not simply be hearers of the word only, but doers also. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray, and all God's people said,
Amen.
So where did it all go wrong? We know that there's a problem with humanity and that Jesus is the solution to that problem, but where did things start to go downhill? Well, the answer to that question primarily comes from this third chapter of the book of Genesis that we call the Fall. And up until this point in God's story, we hear a story of very goodness, that God creates everything that is. Simply this relational God who wants to be in relationship with his people creates humanity as the crowning gem of that creation. There's a universal paradise. There's no sin. There's no evil. There's no suffering. There's no death. But then in the third chapter, we learn about this restriction that we've heard earlier, that you can eat of every tree in the garden except this one tree. Now, what do human beings ultimately do? We do that one thing we're not supposed to do. And so we are introduced to this new character who's a talking serpent, who's more crafty than any of the wild animals that God has made. Now, hindsight being 2020, looking back, we know that this talking serpent is the embodiment of the devil or Satan, the one who comes against Jesus in the wilderness, the one who is like a roaring lion going around seeing who he can devour, the father of lies, the deceiver. And so this serpent comes and poses this question: did God really say? Now, oftentimes temptation comes through that little thought, doesn't it? That's how the devil works. Did God really say you can't do this? Did God really say that you can't take one drink? Or you can't watch that rated R program? Did God really say? Poses that little question in our mind. Did he really say you can't eat from every tree in the garden? And so the woman, speaking back to the serpent, says, God said we can eat of all the trees of the garden, except this one, for if we eat of this tree or even touch it, She embellishes there a little bit. If we even touch it, we'll surely die. And the devil says, you will not surely die. God doesn't want you to eat of this thing because he knows if you eat of this thing, you'll become like God. And so really the first sin, the first temptation that human beings face is to become like God. Like God is withholding something from us that we need. And so Eve is tempted by this fruit in every way. In every dimension of her being, in her heart, in her mind, in her soul, she's tempted by this fruit. First, we see that the fruit is good to eat. That this fruit will fill a physical need that Eve sees. Now, this is bad news for the people called Methodists. Can I get an amen? Because we like to eat. But did you know that temptation can come through what we eat? Did you know that sometimes God gives us very good things like food, but when instinct goes astray, it becomes sin? She sees that it's good to eat, and she also sees that it's beautiful. So there's an aesthetic quality to the fruit. There's something in her soul is compelled to the fruit. You know, sometimes sin comes through the eyes, doesn't it? Sometimes it is what we focus on, things that are made very good in the image of God, the fruit or human bodies, but sin comes through the eyes. We look at things we're not supposed to look at. Jesus says, if your eye offends you, pluck it out. And so Eve sees this fruit and she's compelled. And then finally she sees that the fruit is good for knowledge. So to increase intellect. Now, intellect and reason and the mind, those are good, God-given things. But when we try to elevate our intellect or our thought processes above the God whose ways are higher than our ways and thoughts are higher than our thoughts, then we slip into sin, right? So at every level, Eve is tempted in her heart and her mind, her soul, and then she takes the fruit and she hands it to her husband, who's kind of just a silent partner up until this point. Kind of still like today, he's just along for the ride. Can I get an amen from the husbands? And so they take the fruit together. They're both just as guilty in this incident, and they eat. And their eyes were opened. And they are naked. They are afraid for the first time. But then the next scene is this beautiful portrait of God and God's will for humanity. For God comes to walk with his loved ones, the ones that he created for relationship with them in the cool of the day. But they're nowhere to be found. They're hiding. Someone in our Bible study Wednesday night raised the question, well, why did God even have to put the tree there? Why even do that? Isn't that kind of like telling your kids that you're baking these chocolate chip cookies all day long? You know those chocolate chip cookies with the big chocolate chips? Y'all know what I'm talking about? And the aroma is wafting through the house and you're baking those cookies. And you say, all right, kids, me and Mommy here, we're going to leave. And we're gonna leave the cookies in the cookie jar. We're gonna put the lid on it. Don't touch the cookies because we have guests coming over tonight, and there's one cookie for each person. So, don't touch those cookies. We'll be back. What do y'all think's gonna happen when you come back? The cookies may be totally gone. Yeah, if you're in my house, maybe they take a couple little nibbles off the cookies. Maybe they take a chocolate chip off. Or maybe you come in if you're in the Beck household and the cookie jar is shattered on the floor. There's cookie crumbs everywhere. There's chocolate chips on the ceiling and on the roof. And then you get this blame game thing. No, I didn't do it. No, Michael Jr. did it. No, it wasn't Michael Jr. It was Alex. No, it was Angel. She always gets the short end of the stick. And then finally, yeah. No, it was Vader. It was our little pug. Yeah, he did it. He knocked the cookie jar off and he ate the cookies. Right? Well, that's kind of the situation that we see here. God comes and humanity's hiding, and just like those kids would be, and there's mess everywhere. The fruit of temptation has been consumed, but God's response is not like maybe some of ours would be with a belt in our hand or our timeout clock or however you do that in the day. But he says, where are you? Where are you? Now, God knows full well where human beings are, doesn't he? He's God. He knows they're hiding there in the bushes naked. But this call is about the nature of God, His relentless seeking nature, that He wants to put back together what's been broken. Immediately, right at the start, God, where are you? And God's been calling, where are you, over our lives since the existence of the universe. See, this story of Adam and Eve, this is our story. And all of us have taken of the chocolate chip cookies of temptation. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And God is calling, where are you? So there's some natural, innate consequences that happen for these actions. So, one, the serpent is told, you're going to crawl on your belly all the days of your life. You're going to eat the dust of the earth. The woman, and women, I'm sorry about this. Y'all kind of get the short end of the stick on this. Y'all get to bear children, and through the pain of childbearing. Guys, we got lucky on that one. Can I get an amen? But then the man, now you're going to, by the sweat of your brow, you're going to toil all the days of your life. And God says, the ground itself is cursed because of you. So because of this thing called free will, up until this point, a very good creation, we now see the potential for corruption. And free will, which is a great blessing and also kind of a double-edged sword, because God doesn't make robots. God creates human beings with the same freedom and capacity that God has. So we can choose to exercise free will towards God, to love God, to do beautiful things, to feed the hungry, to cure cancer. Or we can use free will in the wrong direction and do horrible, atrocious things as well, can't we? And human beings exercise free will in the wrong direction, there's cosmic consequences. The ground itself is cursed because of you. You know, when we do, when we have actions in our life, they have consequences. There's a ripple effect that goes out. You know, some of the best things we've ever done in our life, we don't even realize we've done them. Those small little words of encouragement or love or an act of compassion that turns somebody's world right side up. And it's the same thing is true of our bad actions. There's a ripple effect. Y'all ever heard of the butterfly effect? Where a butterfly can flap its wings on one side of the earth and there's some kind of reaction on the other side? Well, this thing called sin ripples out through all creation. And so all of creation is now broken and fallen and marred. God is not the source of evil and suffering. But we know that evil and suffering exists because of this thing called the fall. Now, that doesn't necessarily... while it's a good explanation, doesn't necessarily encourage somebody who's in their deathbed. Or encourage somebody who's holding the hand of their loved one as they die. In fact, it's in those times that sometimes Christians make some statements that are well-meaning and affirming and just trying to bring comfort, but they're entirely inaccurate. You know, pastors, we get to be on the front row of suffering and evil. We get to stand in the funeral homes and the hospice houses. I've laid my hand on a 20-something-year-old woman and prayed over her as she died. And stood in the room with an irate mother and family, offering only the silence of my shoulder. I've been down to the jailhouse and seen the devastating consequences of people's actions and how that changes their life forever. I've seen saints of God who love Jesus with all their heart die of cancer while others were healed. I've seen little children and prayed for them as they fought for life, as they struggled to survive. I've heard the confessions of perpetrators, and I've counseled the victims of abuse, and there is great suffering, and there is evil in this world. And it's in those moments where we try to say, oh, I understand how you feel. Anybody ever hear that one? Or you know, I guess God needed an angel. Or, you know, nothing really happens in God's world by accident. God's going to bring some kind of good out of this. That maybe God just needed another voice in the heavenly choir. Now, if we think about those statements for a moment, we make God this tyrannical, micromanaging God who's in control of every little detail of our lives that happens, right? But when we look at the God of Scripture, we see, yes, there's an aspect of God who's transcendent and high above all the doings of the earth, that He's the cause and everything, and in Him we move and have our being. But there's another aspect of God, that God is chesed. He's love. And love, by its very nature, necessitates vulnerability. You can't love another person and not be vulnerable, right? You love that person. You care for that person. And so if something happens to that person, you're vulnerable. And we hear in the Old Testament about a God who hears the groaning and the oppression of His people. And He comes down and He's committed to act. He cries over His people. He broods over His people like a mother hen. He's the God who feels that brokenness and He's entirely involved. He's a God who, although we don't like to think of God as vulnerable, we like a Superman God with all the omnis that'll come in and save the day. Actually, the God that we reveal, that's revealed to us in Scripture, is a vulnerable, loving God who suffers with us in our affliction and who's with us in the devastating consequences of the world. Now, this God and His unfailing love is utterly, completely revealed in the person of Jesus Christ. The clearest revelation of God that ever was or ever will be in the person of Jesus. We see God face to face, and we see what kind of omnipotence that God actually is. When we look at the cross, that is a demonstration of God's power. Now, it might not be the concept of that we as human beings project onto God of what all-powerfulness looks like. But God shows us in the cross what kind of power He is. He's the selfless, suffering power. That through that cross, God ultimately takes sin and death and evil in on Himself and transforms it. And by being resurrected from the dead, defeats darkness and all those realities of brokenness that we know. It's in the suffering and the resurrection of Jesus Christ that we see the very power of God revealed. And this is what Paul's really wrestling with in the book of Romans in the 8th chapter. He's talked about the cross and the power of Jesus Christ and how that's launched God's plan of new creation for Jew and Scythian, slave, free, male and female, that now there's this new way that we have access to God, that the God who's been calling out, "Where are you?" over our lives for all our existence, has now made a new way to be God with us, because He's a God who refuses to be God without us. And Paul's talking about how do we proclaim the goodness of the God, the hope that we have in this God, but yet we still live in a world of brokenness and evil. And so in the 8th chapter, in the 18th verse, he says, "I consider the sufferings of this present world to be nothing compared to the glory that's coming soon." Amen. Now Paul's a guy who can talk about suffering. He's been through a little. He's been beaten with rods. He's been stoned several times. He's been received the 39 lashes. He's been snake bitten and lost at sea and abandoned and attacked by bandits. He's been imprisoned on numerous occasions for his witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And ultimately, he ends with his head being cut off. He's a guy who knows a little bit about suffering. But Paul says in the midst of all of this suffering and human evil, moral evil, and natural evil, I proclaim that the glory that's coming soon far outweighs any of the suffering that we know. For the creation waits with eager expectation. So here's an image of creation, all the universe, up on tiptoe, waiting for the fullness of what Jesus Christ has done to come into being. And he says, "For this creation is currently subjected to futility. The world as we know it is in a marred and broken state where there's suffering and evil." But he says, "The creation itself will be set free from bondage and decay." See, it's not just human beings that need redemption. It's not just us that need to be redeemed from a state of slavery and bondage and decay. It's the whole universe. And ultimately what Jesus does is not just for us, for humanity, but for the entire cosmos. That Jesus is effecting redemption of the world and everything that we know. For we know that the whole creation is groaning now in the pains of childbearing. Now here's an image of the universe bared down like a woman about to give birth. And all the pain and all the blood and all the groaning that goes with that process. You know, we still haven't figured out how to comfortably remove a child without some blood and some pain. Can I get an amen from the women this morning? Amen. So here's an image of the universe getting ready to bear down. It's shuddering. There's groaning. The universe itself is giving birth to this new creation that has somehow been launched through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And Paul says that in the midst of that suffering, we have the Holy Spirit, which gives us the first fruits of the Spirit. Even in the midst of a broken world, we have love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Then we get to this verse, one of the most powerful in all the New Testament, right? For God so... We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God and who are called according to His purpose. That the God who gave His only begotten Son, that through that now we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose. God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Now, we know that all things work together for the good. All things, good, evil, bad, brokenness, everything in between. But not for everybody. But for those who love God and are called according to His purpose. Now, what is the purpose that God has called us to? Well, Paul goes on, for those He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. Now here we encounter this big word, predestination, right? This word that kind of divides theological camps all across the spectrum. Predestination. Paul says that there is such a thing as predestination. Now we as Wesleyans don't believe in the type of predestination from which these theologies emerge, that God is micromanaging every component of creation, and that God determines before any creation ever was who's going to go to heaven and who's going to go to hell. That God predetermines every single act of earth that's ever going to unfold. We don't believe in that kind of predestination. And in fact, Paul doesn't either. For Paul says, for those He foreknew, He also predestined to what? To be conformed to the image of His Son, Jesus. Right, we who love God and are called according to His purpose, we are predestined to be conformed to the image of Jesus Himself. Now, I know that's a big job for some of y'all. I know some of you. But the end goal is that God is conforming us to the very image of Jesus Christ. That we are becoming in the likeness, the way that Jesus loved, the way that He taught, the way that He lived, we are becoming Jesus. We are being conformed to His image in the order that we come into this big blended family as the first fruits. Then Paul goes on to say, no, in all these things, in the midst of a world that's broken and torn apart, where we suffer and we experience evil, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor cancer, nor disease, nor sickness, nor incarceration, nor poverty, nor HIV, nor mental illness, nor any of these things, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that we have in Christ Jesus. And because we have that love in Christ Jesus, that love that came and bled and died that we might have life, because of that hope that we have as Christian people and what Jesus has done in our life and what He's going to ultimately do in all the universe, because we have that hope and we have that love which we can never be separated from, then we can say with all certitude and all joy that God is good all the time, and all the time God is good, because He's the God who's with us in our suffering. He's the God who comes into our life and holds us in our brokenness. Amen. And He's the God through the omnipotent power of the cross who's bringing all things to a state of newness. I want you to watch this video and think about what Christ has done. Jesus has done in the midst of a sin-broken world. Our Master comes and does life with us. He calls, "Where are you?" And he restores that relationship, and he walks with us, and he talks with us, and he tells us that we are his own. But not only does Jesus come and form this relationship with us, but he dies. He gives his life so that we can live. He gives us his heart. And so inside each one of us is a piece of the Master. But we can't keep that heart. We can't keep that piece to ourselves. We got to give it away to keep it. For there are people in this world who need that love and need that heart that only we can give. Jesus comes down into our sin-broken lives in the midst of suffering and evil, and he gives us his heart so that we can live. But he calls us to be organ donors in a world torn apart by death and disease and destruction. Are we giving our heart away, church? Are we trying to die with all our organs inside of us? Are we passing on the life and the love that Christ has given us to the next generation and to the people that don't know him? You know, I grew up in a world of strange dualities, a world of darkness and light. My mother was a beautiful child of God, created in the image of God, who had a horrible disease called addiction. And ultimately, she abandoned me at birth. My biological father was unknown, but my grandparents stepped in, raised me in the church in the most formative years of my life, and then they died when I was young. And so I grew up in a world of great dualities. a world of tough, hard, mean streets and soft church pew cushions. I grew up in a world where I knew deep hunger pain and extravagant potluck spreads. I grew up in a world where I knew merciless perpetrators and selfless saints. A world of darkness and light. But it's through the love of God's people, it's through the love of the church and the people who are willing to pass the heart of Christ on to me that I came to know God's love for myself. In the midst of a world that's broken and torn apart by sin, it's not our job to simply give an explanation, but our witness and our presence. Sometimes words aren't even necessary, but just being with people in the brokenness, being with people in their suffering. For that's what Christ has done for us, and that's what we are called to do through and in Christ for others. And so we can stand hand in hand and heart to heart and say in a world that's torn apart, in a world of great dualities of light and darkness, we can say with great certainty that God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. And every time we come to this table, we come to the table of the Master who came to do life with us. We come to the table of the one who gave us his heart. Not only does he live with us, but he dies for us so that we might truly live. He gives us the heart that we need to go on. And every time we are brought to this table, we are faced with the reality that there's a good God that created everything that is, and there's suffering and evil, and that God's answer to suffering and evil is his own self-giving in his own resurrection from the dead. And so we come to this table and we proclaim those three essentials of the mystery of our faith, that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and that Christ will come again. And every time we come to this table, we taste of the goodness and the love of God who came down into our brokenness and our sin and our suffering to redeem our world from the inside out. We come to the table that is the hope of new creation, where we too are made new. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up, Lord.